Welcome to New Hampshire's WildSide. I'm Christina Loopy.
And I'm Mark Beauchamp. We'll take you behind the scenes of the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department to learn more about the people and projects of your Fish and Wildlife Agency.
We'll also give you tips and tactics that you can use to make the most out of your time in New Hampshire's woods and waters.
And along the way, we'll meet real people who love life outdoors.
Now, let's discover more about New Hampshire's WildSide.
Would you like to try to?
Throughout the state, the New Hampshire Fish and Game's Aquatic Resources Education Program, or ARE, engages students in exploring the science and recreational opportunities within their own watersheds. One school that has fully incorporated the ARE program into its science and physical education curriculum is the Wendigo School in Windsor.
Live feed, and you guys will all be doing your warm-ups, and then we'll get ready to go.
We are a placement school for about 50 students who come to see us from difficulties with other educations that they've received in the past. And the students we work with have social, emotional, and behavioral difficulties, and they come to us to receive an education. Our school is middle school through high school. It's something that I feel like with the students that we have this age, it's an activity that the students really seem to enjoy and, you know, can experience.
The ARE program teaches students how to keep their watersheds healthy for fish and wildlife and how to fish safely, legally, and with skill.
Yeah, you like fishing?
Students at the Wendigo School get a complete hands-on outdoor experience.
Some good fishing here.
We use the Watershed Education Program as well as the Let's Go Fishing Program as a year-round curriculum in a lot of our classes. So it's either a physical education connection, biology connection, where we're focusing on ecology. We incorporate the water quality testing. We also do the macroinvertebrates to determine water quality as well of our watershed. And then we also do the species collection and the warm water tank. So we're able to monitor and observe behavior of as many species as we can, vertebrates and invertebrates, over the course of a school year.
With such a personal connection, the students are motivated to participate.
Slow and steady, look before you leap. Okay.
I think the students are really excited to participate in this program because it's something that they get to get outside, they get to do a lot of hands-on activities, and they get to really work together with their peers to do a lot of what we do. Some students may have more experience than others where they get to help each other and learn together, but it's an activity where anybody can connect with it.
Part of the curriculum is studying warm water fish that they have collected from Black Pond.
Having an aquarium in the classroom, I think, it's always new and fresh, and every day you don't know what you're gonna walk in on. And so when we come in and, you know, observe the fish's behavior, we try and get a head count and see how many fish we have from the day before. And we really try and get a good idea of are there any macros and vertebrates that weren't there the night before. Just observing the differences in their behavior, looking at the different sizes. Some of the fish are more aggressive and more territorial than others. And so I think that it's just been really great to be able to have the students see the interactions.
Once they study the fish in the tank, students have a chance to try to catch their own, learning how challenging it can be.
In more of our physical education aligned classes, that's when we get to get outside and do ice fishing in the winter if the ice is thick enough, and then also the shoreline angling when the ice is out.
This program is about more than just catching fish.
When we go out and participate in our fishing activities, my goal for the activity is for that every student has a really positive experience. I want every student to make sure that they're practicing what we're learning in the classroom, that they are feeling supported, but also taking risks to bait their own hooks if they need to, or to tie their own knots, so that they are learning and gaining knowledge. But overall, really more than anything, it's important for us to be able to make sure that students are being ethical, but as well as just really having a positive experience with the activity. You know, even if they don't catch a fish, the goal is the process and the activity itself.
All of these activities lead to a better understanding and connection with their local watershed.
We've learned a lot about Black Pond. We've been able to make direct connections with the pond based on what we see in the classroom. So we've tried to simulate the ecosystem as much as possible, and being able to get into the pond, putting the waders on, pulling out, some of the substrate and being able to explore all of the organisms has really been an eye-opening experience for myself and the students. The two programs really work well hand in hand, and it's really nice to be able to have the opportunity to offer those programs to our students.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Judy Tomosa. I work with the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department, and I'm the one that got you permitted to have your fish tank.
The program also allows students to learn about the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department and its mission.
The relationship that we've been able to have with the Fish and Game Department, I think, has been great for our school and for our students. And I feel like it's really sort of turned them on to some of the activities that are right outside their front door that they can participate in. We have a lot of different students, a lot of different strengths within our students, and so we differentiate a lot of instruction here. And this program allows us to support students within these activities in a variety of different exercises.
Whatever the age of the student, this watershed experience leaves a lasting impression.
So there's a variety of different arrangements that we can offer the students through these natural resources and through this program. And that's something that I really feel like is beneficial for our school and could be any school. It's something that they can continue to do. It's not something that's just going to be in high school or college. Like, they can do this forever and pass it on, and they'll have something that they can really take advantage of when they have the knowledge.
You were using plastics?
Yeah.
No worms, no crawlers?
I used one at the end, and I feel like I got more bites.
Use the hashtag BetterOutside when you share photos and videos showing how you connect with life outdoors. And don't forget to tag New Hampshire Fish and Game on Facebook and Instagram.
With over 975 lakes and ponds to play on, it's better outside because we're here connecting you to life outdoors. Now watch this.
It's a beautiful Lake Winnipesaukee spring morning on Ron Smagula's boat, the Rocket Troll. Along with Ron are fisheries biologists John Vire and Don Miller. The goal is twofold, to catch a New Hampshire landlocked salmon and practice the Salmon Angler's Pledge. The Salmon Angler's Pledge is a series of guidelines that salmon anglers can volunteer to take, from using rubber nets to selective harvest. It's all about minimizing negative impacts to this valuable fishery.
One on this one too.
Oh my goodness.
Double.
Yep.
I believe it's a little guy. Yeah, I've got about 8 to 10 feet of line left. I'm going to try and scoop the fish over here because Don has another one on that side. Get his head out of the water, scoop him up, get another grip. And look to see exactly how the fish is hooked. Don't just grab the hook and twist it around and hope the fish comes out. Look in there, gut it. Oh.
The no clip, it's a 4-year-old, and you'll note the hook wound here. And that's a spawned out female. And again, while it's a nice fish, what we're trying to stress to folks is, if you look at that side with the clean maxilla, you see the sides where it's clearly ripped off. Some of the non-hook wounded 4-year-old salmon are 22 inches and a legitimate 4 pounds.
Put it right in there, Jono.
And we're going to get that back in the lake. Yep. We're choosing not to harvest any fish today, but if you were going to harvest the fish, what the Landlocked Salmon Angler Pledge tells us is that would be the perfect fish to harvest. It's got a hook wound. It's behind in growth for its age. Someone else will enjoy catching that fish, but if you're interested in harvesting some salmon, that would be the fish to keep.
Every fall, biologists net salmon to check their health and condition. It's also the time when they strip them of their eggs, which will be raised in the hatchery system.
Going right out of her. I barely have to touch her.
On this particular trip, the fish are being put aside for New Hampshire Fish and Game's popular Salmon Sunday event. Normally, the salmon are returned to the lake as soon as the eggs are taken. It was during the fall netting that Don and John became concerned with the salmon that they were netting.
About 5 years ago, we started to note hook wounds on these fish to the point where it bothered both John and I, so we started tabulating the data. I believe the first year we saw 8 or 10%, now we're up to 34% 5 years later. So it's a meteoric rise, to say the least.
The effect of hook wounds on salmon caused the fish to grow slower, as much of the fish's energy goes to repairing these wounds.
This is a 5-year-old salmon, grossly undersized for its age. Blinded in one eye, corner of the jaw is rehealed, but you can quite easily see where the hook wound occurred. Another 3-year-old salmon. This is an extreme hook wound on this one also. You can see there's been a hole created in its lower jaw. So this fish is probably having a tough time just forcing water over its gills, obviously. The action of pumping water over the gills is pretty much impaired by that hole in the lower jaw.
A lot of times when these fish are young, anglers will try to shake them off, either with pliers or just shake them with their hands, trying to get the hooks out. And oftentimes that'll set the hooks deeper and cause more damage.
Anglers are taking more responsibility, and Don and John continue to work hard to get the word out about hook wounds. But their free time, it's all about fishing.
We're keeping busy here putting new hooks on the line. These fine wire hooks, they bend easily, and I think that in the long run probably do less damage to the fish than a thicker hook. When you're using downriggers, sometimes if you're not watching the rods, a fish will hit. Smaller yearling salmon oftentimes won't even set off the release. So it's always a good idea if you've gone a few minutes, check that downrigger rod just to make sure you're not dragging a small salmon around.
A strong age class of fish is maturing, and word has gotten out about the salmon angler's pledge, which many anglers now practice.
Here's another one.
That these guys are going to save us a ton of aged tubes.
Using rubber nets, knowing where your pliers are, and minimal handling of the fish help reduce injuries.
Hook came out nice. It's another little 2-year-old.
Let them chill out. Little guy's pretty frisky.
Look to see exactly how the fish is hooked. Don't just grab the hook and twist it around and hope the fish comes out. Look in there, got it?
That's a triple. Again, they're all 2-year-olds, so we've located quite a pot of fish here up in the bay.
By taking the pledge, anglers can help the salmon fishery stay strong while they continue to enjoy pursuing this popular game fish. We hope you enjoyed this episode of New Hampshire's WildSide. Be sure to check back for new content at nhwildside.com. I'm Mark Beauchamp.
And I'm Christina Lupi. Thanks for watching.